Welcome to the Demystifying Medicine YouTube channel. When you think of the word asthma, what's the first thing you think of? Shortness of breath? Loud coughing? Perhaps an inhaler? If you didn't know already, asthma is a chronic condition that affects the airways that carry air in and out of your lungs. While common symptoms of asthma include difficulty breathing, coughing, and wheezing, certain individuals may experience more debilitating symptoms than others. Serving as the leading chronic disease in children, asthma affects 26.5 million Americans, 6.1 million of which are children. Asthma can be divided into two categories, allergic and non-allergic. While functionally similar, these two differ in terms of their trigger. Allergic asthma, which makes up 60 to 90% of all cases, is triggered by allergens such as pollen, mold, pet hair, and many others. When an allergic asthmatic is exposed to allergen proteins, these are recognized by the immune system, triggering an immune response against them. The response to allergens causes the lungs to swell and overproduce mucus in the airways, which constricts breathing and triggers asthma. Non-allergic asthma, on the other hand, is triggered by other factors such as stress, temperature, and exercise. Almost 10% of people with asthma in the United States have severe asthma, which is difficult to manage, even with prescription medications. One of the most common forms of asthma is driven by immune cells called eosinophils. Eosinophils are a type of white blood cell that help regulate the immune system and fight off infections and diseases. However, as eosinophil levels increase, mucus production also increases and excessive swelling occurs in the airways. A common question that is often asked about asthma is, since eosinophilic asthma is driven by the body's own immune system, would it be considered an autoimmune disorder? To answer this, we need to explore what autoimmunity is. Autoimmunity occurs when the cells in the immune system, like B and T cells, mount a response to the body's normal cells, which can cause damage to tissues and organs over time. B cells produce antibodies that counter invading bacteria, viruses, and toxins, whereas T cells react to the body's own cells that have become infected. Antibodies are proteins produced to counteract specific internal or environmental stimuli like allergens. While the cause of eosinophilic asthma is unknown, there is growing evidence suggesting that autoimmune factors may directly contribute to the disease. Dr. Manali Mukherjee, an assistant professor from McMaster University, conducts research that focuses on defining the pathogenesis behind eosinophilic asthma as well as its implications for autoimmunity. With her input, we will provide some insight into the mechanisms behind the two concepts and examine why modern research suggests that the two may be more closely related than previously thought. From Dr. Mukherjee, we learn that the primary mechanism of allergic asthma involves a special class of T cells called type 2 helper T cells, which are commonly referred to as Th2 cells. When exposed to allergens, these cells release cytokines, or cell messenger proteins, like IL-5 and IL-13, which recruit eosinophils. When this happens, Th2 cells also stimulate B cells to release immunoglobulin E antibodies, which causes some of the symptoms of allergic asthma. The release of immunoglobulin E antibodies activates epithelial cells, which in turn start to upregulate the release of more cytokines. This ultimately triggers a cycle in the airways and leads to the presentation of worsened asthmatic symptoms. We stated that immunoglobulin E antibodies excite epithelium cells, but what exactly happens? Epithelial tissue or the epithelium is found in the skin and the lining of our organs. It forms a barrier that helps defend against infections and allergens. When the homeostasis within the epithelium becomes disrupted due to excess allergens, the epithelium produces excess inflammatory cells and becomes increasingly sensitive to allergens. More specifically, when the balance is disrupted, the epithelium gets upregulated and releases Th2-associated cytokines that are pro-inflammatory, like IL-5 and IL-13. The constant release of Th2-associated cytokines is what renders asthma a chronic condition. The release of these creates an environment where more eosinophils are recruited. Eosinophils release a network known as eosinophil extracellular traps, EETs, which are a web of molecules that are composed of DNA fibers and proteins. These traps aim to capture and kill microorganisms. As the number of eosinophils increases, EET levels increase as well. High EET levels stimulate epithelial cells, which activates Th2-associated cytokines production and contributes to inflammation and tissue damage. One of the ways that asthma can be treated is through the inhalation of traditional anti-inflammatory drugs, like corticosteroids. However, the more eosinophils are involved, the less effective traditional treatments are. In the case where the epithelium gets stimulated, inflammation may continue to persist, despite the use of low or medium dose inhalers. Dr. Mukherjee states that the chronic inflammation seen in asthma is what leads to corticosteroid insensitivity. Corticosteroids can be used to reduce the level of inflammation, attenuate the symptoms of asthma, and maintain lung health. While corticosteroids normally suppress the immune system, if a large enough dose is not administered to patients with eosinophilic asthma, then the use of corticosteroids instead leads to more eosinophilic production because the white blood levels will dip below normal. A problem arises, however, when there is persistent inflammation. Here, immune cells that promote inflammation tend to increase. However, there are not enough regulatory immune cells to help manage the inflammation. This makes it harder to manage the autoimmune response when white blood cells enter into the airway in response to an allergen. Overall, Dr. Mukherjee's research aims to understand the mechanisms of inflammation in the airways of patients with asthma as well as define the response to therapies for autoimmunity and asthma. As of now, eosinophilic asthma would not be considered an autoimmune disorder itself, but scientists are investigating the potential underlying autoimmune mechanisms that contribute to the outcomes of this severe form of asthma. By uncovering the related pathways that exist in airway autoimmunity, scientists can help create targeted treatments and improve the quality of life of eosinophilic asthma patients in the future. Thank you for watching. Please do not forget to like and comment on our video and subscribe to the Demystifying Medicine channel.